9 million dog owners in Britain today. Many of them are battling to be top dog at home.
Look, you can't go behind me.
But one man believes there's no such thing as a naughty dog.
I'm not going near her.
Just struggling owners.
Swansea, enough!
You think you've got a problem now, and you have. You're really not in control.
And that's when master dog trainer Graeme Hall steps in to take on the nation's dog owners.
I've worked with almost every breed of dog and all kinds of dog behaviour problems, but 9 times out of 10, it's the owners that need to change their behaviour. And that is a really tough message to get across. The problem I got with you is, what you're not doing is any sort of correction at all.
With 12 years' experience, Graham's been put to the test thousands of times.
Come on, let's run.
And the results speak for themselves.
No.
Well done, baby.
Well done.
Honestly, it'll change my life.
In his casebook this week, Graeme has to keep his distance.
I'm not overly keen on getting too much closer.
No, I would neither.
And find a novel way to get one nervous canine under control.
Hi, Karen, can you read me?
An unpredictable Jack Russell called Patch, who has his owners living in fear.
1 minute he can be playing, and then the next minute he'll just turn around and bite you.
Labrador cross Sophie, who is driving her owner barking mad.
One day, she's going to stress me out so much that I will have an accident.
First, Graeme is on his way to Essex to meet Karen and John, a couple who've devoted their lives to saving dogs and currently share their home with 5 rescues.
Hello, guys. Hello. Hello, Gussie. Hello, Doodle.
Hello, mate. Hello. Yes, we have to stroke you as well, don't we? Yes.
Hello.
While Doodle, Nada, Gus and Ella show John lots of love and affection, latest rescue Mojo...
Mojo.
...hates him.
Hello.
As soon as he sees me, he starts. Bark, bark, growl, growl. And it's every time. Every single time. It's upsetting because you start to think it's me, he doesn't like me. All any dog owners want is they want to be loved by their animals.
Do you want some dinner? Din-dins.
Let's get there, mate. Come on. There's actually no physical contact.
While Mojo avoids being anywhere near John, he's a different dog around wife Karen.
You're gonna come play. You're gonna come play. Yeah, good boy. You're working out.
Mojo.
Boy.
Hello.
With John unable to get close enough to Mojo to even put him on a lead, it's good left boy. To Karen to do the lion's share of Mojo's day-to-day care.
I feel that I can't really go out for long periods of time.
Come on, Mojo.
So I have to take him out sort of for a pee and a poo. You know, if I'm not there...
Good boy, come on. It's okay.
He's gonna have to use a nappy pad because he won't come to John. I feel quite frustrated and very trapped.
Good boy.
Mojo was 1 year old when the charity the couple work for rescued him from death row in Romania. And they have no idea what lies behind his hatred of men.
He was found dumped in a sack with his brothers and sisters. There was 4 of them in total.
We're trying to do the very best for him because he deserves it, because he's a lovely dog.
Well, he didn't ask for any of it.
No.
But this troubled terrier's behaviour is putting a strain on their relationship.
It's making us miserable, isn't it?
Mm. It's definitely caused arguments and I would say a bit of resentment.
Yeah.
On your behalf because he's bonded to me and not you. And mine is I've got to do everything with him because you can't.
We haven't got to the it's me or the dog stage yet. Although...
We've come close.
We have come close to it.
Now, Mojo is a terrier cross from Romania, and that's a country that's got a really big problem with stray dogs. In the capital, Bucharest, there are 60,000 dogs living on the streets, and some of them are subjected to terrible conditions. So I'm keeping a really open mind about what Mojo's problems are, because we'll never know what happened to him in his early life. Oh, hello. Hello. Oh, hello.
Hello.
Hello. Karen.
Hi, Graeme.
Hiya. Nice to meet you.
Come on in.
Come on, then. Very good.
girl.
So what do you know about Mojo then?
He's very, very wary. The only person he'll actually let cuddle him, touch him, is me.
OK. And with you, John?
He just barks, runs off, growls.
Right.
And that's it. But it's everybody.
Right.
Mostly men.
Yeah.
Yeah. OK. How does that make you feel?
Terrible, to be honest with you. It's upsetting. I can't get very close to him. I just want him to be a normal dog and come and say hello, Dad, wag his tail and let me give him a stroke.
Yeah,
And it's as simple as that.
Is it causing a bit of tension between you?
Oh, big star, yeah.
Yeah. It's the only thing we argue about.
He's reliant on me. There's no way I could go and leave him with John.
Mm.
Absolutely no way.
I can't
he could
get
have
him
fed
out.
Him, he wouldn't be able to get him for a walk.
Can't know. Get him out. Okay.
I can't get a lead on him.
Oh, really? Right.
We love him to bits.
We do love him to bits. We can't, you know, give up on him, really.
And we don't want to give up on him.
Graeme needs to see how Mojo reacts with both Karen and John. First up is Karen.
He's a good boy. Oh, what a good boy. Good boy.
Calmness reigns.
Yeah, he's very calm.
But as soon as John enters the room, Mojo becomes agitated.
I'm not overly keen on getting too much closer.
No,
to him,
I wouldn't either. I mean, we don't need to stress him out too much.
Good boy.
Ah, really? Good boy?
While Mojo is clearly uncomfortable with John in the room, his hostility rises even further when Karen leaves.
Already there's a bigger problem. So what have you got to approach him now, then? I didn't know what to do. Gone. So the reason he was running around was he was trying to escape, but I was in the door.
Yeah.
As soon as I moved out of the way, he's off like a little rocket.
So every time I come home and Karen's not here, that's what I get.
Right. I need to reprogram Mojo to trust men, but this is going to be a tough one. How can I help to train a dog that's petrified of men when I can't get anywhere near?
Coming up, emotions run high.
Bless you.
As Graeme tries to teach Mojo, he can be man's best friend.
It does get to you now and again, this job.
And a confrontational Jack Russell who's in danger of losing his place in the family home.
It's a shame to have him put to sleep because he is a healthy dog, but unfortunately, things can't carry on the way they are.
Today, master dog trainer Graeme Hall is in Essex, helping Romanian rescue Mojo, whose anxiety around men is making him reactive towards new owner John.
Little in the corner is Mojo.
While his behaviour with wife Karen is completely different, which is putting pressure on their relationship. Having seen how Mojo acts towards men, Graeme wants to share his thoughts with the couple.
Good boy.
I think there's a few things I'm seeing. Karen, you're saying good boy.
Yes.
While he's growling.
Yes.
So he clearly thinks growling, good boy. OK, so it's about fear. So why is it he's a bit funny about men? Well, we're bigger, we've got deeper voices, and we walk around in a slightly clumsy fashion compared to ladies. And what's happening here in the house, you're wading in sort of full on, going, come here, lad, you're all... And it's too much.
Yeah.
So what I want to do is make it easy for him by starting outside, because there's less pressure. He's not cooped up, he's not backed into a corner in any way. Put him in a situation where he's getting used to you.
Yeah.
And then, once we've got that, we translate that back to a more difficult situation, like your living room. So we need to start the training outside.
OK, good.
Mojo is terrified of all men, and so he goes into fight and flight mode every time he's scared. So to break the cycle, we need to teach him that not all men are bad and that John is a good guy. I need John to be able to get up close and personal with a calm Mojo. And the key to Mojo feeling calm and safe is to use my secret weapon, Karen.
So Graeme doesn't stress Mojo out any further by being near him. He's standing back to give John the best chance of building a bond and he's come up with a way to train from a distance with walkie-talkies.
Garen, it's your call because you can see Mojo better than I can. If you think he looks really petrified,
then I need you to pick up the walkie-talkie and let us know stop, and we'll get John not to go any further. Yeah, just stop there, John.
Now Graeme wants to get John gradually close enough to sit down beside Mojo. But as John gets closer, Mojo's anxiety builds.
No.
But Karen is able to calm him with a clear no command.
OK, I can see Mojo's calmed down a bit now, isn't he? Yeah.
So a bit of praise and then we'll go again.
Good boy.
Good boy.
OK, John, when you're ready.
No.
Wait there. John,
he's not going to move. We'll just leave him there.
You can do your thing, Karen, that's right.
Boy, boy.
Mojo's looking now, but he's not
reacting, is he?
No, he's not. Good
Great.
Boy.
So, you see, the message here is you can look at John and you don't have to react. And if you do that, Mum will stroke you and love you.
Good boy.
And with only a few feet to go, can John take a seat next to him?
Boy.
You can see where this is leading, can't you?
Good boy.
How are you, Karen?
Yeah, very calm. A very, very tiny little growl, but nothing really at all. Good. No. No.
That's it. We're getting there. How does he feel to you?
He feels fine. He doesn't look particularly stressed to me.
But the real test is, will Mojo allow John to touch him for the first time ever?
Right, John, what
you're going to do is you're going to take your left hand and just sort of drop it down towards him
slowly. That's it. Now, with an open hand, just sort of offer it underneath his chin. Give him a little tickle on the chest.
Boy. Good boy.
Great. And how's he reacting, Karen?
Brilliant. And he's slightly wary, but
he's putting up with it. He's, you know, he's like, oh, OK, this is not so bad.
Good boy. Hey.
Oh, look, he's moved his head towards you. He wanted more.
Now Mojo has accepted John as not being a threat. He wants affection from him.
Good boy. He's a good boy.
That makes me really happy. Bless him.
Hello.
Good boy.
Hello.
Good boy.
It does get to you now and again, this job, when you're not expecting it. Mojo has just gone from being really wary, really scared, to John's given a tickle like he's always wanted to. And when he stops, Mojo actually puts his head back, says, please, Dad, do it again. Watching a couple on a bench with a dog looking quite normal. It's great. Oh. Job's a good one.
I'm really pleased with how it went. I'm really happy with the progress we made. By the end of it, he was such a calmer, happier dog. I think it's really good.
Yeah, very pleased.
I'm really pleased to see that Mojo is getting close to John, because there's obviously a bit of a bond beginning there. But it's one thing to get close to your dog outside in a neutral space and quite another to do it at home. But that's a challenge for another day.
It's a new day and Graeme is in Watford to meet a family who needs help with their Jack Russell, Patch. Kevin, Dawn and daughter Beth got Patch when he was a puppy because they wanted a cute, cuddly family pet. But 6 years on, this confrontational canine is anything but.
Patch is a bit Jekyll and Hyde, isn't he?
You don't know what he's going to do. He's going to react at any one time. It could be different one minute to the next minute. There's nothing that triggers it, I don't think.
You can look at him or you can turn to talk to me in the evening and Patch will just fly at you. If I go to scratch my leg, he'll try and bite my hands. One minute he can be playing and then the next minute he'll just turn around and bite you.
Patch's unpredictable outbursts mainly happen on the sofa, and attempts to try to curb his behaviour have failed.
I've taken Patch to dog training to try and sort of calm him down, but we got thrown out because he went for another dog.
I've bought probably every dog book going. I've Googled it to try and find out what I think his problem might be. I've taken Patch to the vets to check that he's everything's OK.
There's nothing medically wrong with him.
No, there's nothing medically wrong with him. He's just a devil dog.
The family has put up with his behaviour so far. But time for Patch is running out.
We're at the end of our tether now.
Yeah, don't really know where else to go with him.
We wouldn't rehome him because it wouldn't be fair to put that onto somebody else. Just nothing seems to be working and we desperately need help with him before he injures one of us or somebody else.
And if Graeme can't help, they're even considering the unthinkable.
It's a shame to have him put to sleep because he is a healthy dog, but unfortunately, things can't carry on the way they are.
Jack Russells are dogs with many facets, and they can be anything you want them to be, great working dogs or pets, but it's down to the owners to train them to be that.
Hi, Graham.
Good morning.
Hello. Pleased to meet you.
That'll be Patch, then. Shall we go in before we lose him?
Come in.
Go on, in you go.
Obviously, be a bit wary. If he does jump on you, don't stroke him, because he will bite you.
Oh, really? Right.
One minute he can be fine, and the next minute...
Like that's
what he does.
You look scared to death.
I'm sitting here stiff, because even moving my hands...
Yeah.
We've had 4 years of this now.
Blimey. So what triggers him?
There isn't really anything that does trigger him. It does seem to be when he's settling down, like how he's sitting now, he's just a Jekyll and Hyde dog.
Yeah. Blimey. What was that for?
Yeah, she didn't even move.
No, for no reason. And how does that make you feel, Beth? You're very brave.
It's quite scary, but, like, you're sort of used to it now because, like, he does it all the time.
Why do you let him up?
To be fair, I think if you've... With a dog, you should be able to stroke it on the sofa. If he's going to be in his bed on the floor, we might as well have him stuffed, because then he's just going to be in
That's
his bed.
That's the other alternative.
Yeah, I think that might be the only alternative. But what I've been trying to do is sort of let him know he can come on the sofa when I let him, but as soon as he's naughty, he gets off. He doesn't seem to get it. 30 seconds later, he's back standing there barking to get back up on the sofa.
Right. And who gives him first?
Me.
For Graham to see the full picture, he wants to see what happens when the family takes up their usual position on the sofa.
That seems to be the point when he's like that, if you move or...
Yeah.
That's when he...
But he almost gets you into a false sense of security and suddenly he'll just go for you.
Right. So all you did there was put your hand on the sofa. So how many times do you think he's bitten people now?
Us? I've lost count of how many times he's bitten us. It's right. At least 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times a day.
A day?
A day.
Wow. Is it last chance saloon for him?
It is last chance saloon for him because he's
going again. So how do you discipline him?
I tell him no and I'll get him off the sofa. I wouldn't be able to get him off by touching him.
Right. So how would you do that now?
Sorry. Patch, no. See, the more I shout at him, the more he's... No. Get down. Get down. Get down. Get down.
He's got the ump now.
Get down. No. What are you doing? And it's...
And then it's over.
It's over.
So once you've got him off the sofa, end of.
Yeah.
Pretty much. No dog owner wants to be in a position where they have to put their dog down, but I can see that Patch is unpredictable. And this is one of the most extreme cases that I've come across. And I fear that if I can't help Dawn and Kevin, there might not be any other options open to them.
Coming up, has Graham bitten off more than he can chew with Patch?
Her barking is non-stop.
And can Graham get Sophie, the car-hating Labrador cross, on the road to recovery?
It's like someone blowing a horn right in your ear.
In Watford, master dog trainer Graeme Hall has been called to the rescue of Dawn, Kevin and daughter Beth, who are living in fear of their unpredictable Jack Russell, Patch. Having seen how Patch behaves when they're all sat together on the sofa, Graham thinks the family needs to take back control.
So we should put a lead on him. And that means you can then move him off the sofa, you can just lead him on.
Okay.
Patch needs to learn right from wrong. So when he does something that's not acceptable, he will be told to stop it, and there will be a consequence. Time out away from the family.
I think we put him here in the kitchen behind the door. Give him a moment. Calm down. OK, good boy. Try again.
OK.
Naughty step.
Naughty step for dogs, in effect.
Yeah.
Patch has been like this for at least 4 years, so it's unrealistic to think I'm going to turn him into a lovely, cuddly pet overnight. But we need to get on the right track. There's a lot hanging on this training. If it doesn't go to plan, then the future's looking pretty bleak for Patch. At least that's a settle like this. This is where you can be in danger sometimes, isn't it?
Yeah.
In order to teach Patch to understand what is and what is not acceptable, Graeme needs to introduce a zero-tolerance approach. As soon as Patch starts to growl, Dawn must use a firm stop it command and lead him off the sofa into time out.
So, Kevin, what if you went to stroke him now? Let's see. And, Dawn, you need to be ready, but without tensing.
We'll try and bite me.
Try it. Right, I'm letting you
No, stop it.
And off. Time out. Right, shut the door. That's it.
Patch wants to be with his family, so shutting him in the kitchen shows him that if he can't behave in an acceptable way, he can't sit with them. Eventually, Patch should start to associate stop it with separation and respond to the command on its own.
Yeah. Oh.
That's a shame. So...
Once he's calmed down, Graeme lets him back in.
In you come.
However, Patch isn't ready to give up his command over the couch just yet.
Stop it.
And out.
Out.
That's it. Reset. Try again. Now, good lad.
Come on in.
There we go. And
out. Stop it.
We'll get there in a minute. See what he does. That's it, and that's probably enough.
By following a no-nonsense approach...
Well done, that was the lightest of growls. That's it, well done. That was very cool.
And after several sessions in time out...
Stop it.
Patch starts to respond to the command on its own.
And then, good lad.
Good boy.
He seems a lot better.
Yeah, it does, doesn't he?
You've just leaned down and scratched your ankle.
I would never have done that before.
No.
Boosted by their progress and with Patch now calm and under control, Graeme wants Beth to try and stroke him.
Dawn, any hints of anything, stand up, because that then blocks. He can't get to Beth, right? And he's straight out. So, you ready?
Yeah.
Go on then, go for it. There, that's fine.
Good boy.
I'm going to do that one more time, and then we're nearly there. There you go. That's it. And back out. Yeah, good. So that's the first time in years you've been able to stroke him like that. Right. Yeah. How do you feel?
Happy.
Yeah, good.
Never in a million years would have thought that she'd be able to lean over me and stroke him.
Yeah.
It's a great result for Beth. In less than an hour, Graeme has transformed Patch from a devil dog into a passive pooch sitting silently on the sofa. But before he leaves, Graeme has one final challenge. He wants to see Patch sitting with the family on the sofa without his lead.
If he doesn't listen to the stop it, you stand up. I go, right, you're out.
OK.
So it's exactly the same as before, just there's no lead anymore.
Right, OK.
Yeah. Lovely. I don't really want him to react, but if he does, you know what to do.
Yeah.
So why don't you pretend to turn the telly on, Kevin?
Yeah. Well, you can actually watch on telly tonight.
Yeah, we'll be able to turn the TV over tonight.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hopefully.
There you go. Put it back down again. Good lad. Perfect. I'm really pleased. So he's not on lead anymore.
No. It's almost as if it's a different dog sitting there.
Yeah, it's good, isn't it? So the thing I was really worried about when I first came was, you know, he was in last chance really here. How do you think we're doing on that score?
After seeing the difference that you've made in just an hour, I think we've got a good chance now.
Mm.
Of being able to keep him under control.
So I think I'll leave you in peace. It's been really good.
It has.
So, yeah, put it there, Beth. All the best. Dawn.
Lovely, thank you very much.
All the best, Kevin.
Thank you, Grant.
Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.
I felt quite nervous when he asked me to stroke him because I definitely thought he was going to bite me, but he didn't.
I think Graham's fantastic. He's done a marvellous job on Patch and on us. We've put up with this for 4 years. If we'd known it was this simple, we would have called Graham a lot sooner.
At the start of the day today, I was really worried about Patch's future. Well, to put it bluntly, I wasn't sure whether he had one. I think this was a life and death situation. And he's definitely got a life now. This family know how to deal with his issues, and there's no reason why he should be put in a position where he ends up being put to sleep. And that's a great feeling.
See ya.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Next, Graham is on his way to Leicestershire to meet a great-grandmother who needs help with her black Labrador cross.
Go!
Christina took rescue dog Sophie in after suffering tragic, life-changing events.
My dog, Pollyanna, died in February of 17, and then a month later, my husband died. I was very, very lonely.
I'm talking to you.
Taking on a rescue dog from a shelter felt like the perfect way to get over her loss.
Very important to have a companion. Very.
Sit.
Whilst in many ways Sophie is the perfect companion...
Good girl. Okay? That's it.
There's one aspect of her behaviour which is seriously impacting on Christina's independence.
In.
Her barking is non-stop.
It's piercing. It's making my head hurt already. It's like someone blowing a horn right in your ear.
As we go along, she gets louder. One day, she's going to stress me out so much that I will have an accident. Because I live alone, I like to get out of the house as much as possible. I get bored and I need to talk to people.
Not wanting to leave Sophie home alone for hours, but unable to take her in the car with her to visit friends, Christina is starting to feel isolated and has tried every trick in the book to make her journeys with Sophie bearable.
I tried her in a cage. I bought a collar that vibrated on her throat when she barked. I sang to her.
Go to sleep, my baby. Close your pretty eyes.
I even recited poetry to her. That didn't work. None of them worked. I love her to bits. I'll get her right if it kills me.
I really feel for Christina because she got Sophie to sort of help her out through her grief. But it sounds as though, you know, Sophie's just made her life really hard work. The dogs barking in cars isn't entirely unusual. If they're not used to travelling in cars, for example, it can be a bit worse. And it depends on their history as well. So I'm interested to hear what's gone on with Sophie. There we go. Hello. Hello. You're lovely. Nice to meet you.
And to you. And right. Meet you too.
Yeah, very welcome. So what's her background then? Do you know much about her?
I do know. She actually lived with this lady who was put in a home.
Right.
So the dog was then taken to animal aid, and I think it was the first time in a car.
Ah, right. So the first time she was in a car, she was being taken away from home.
That's right.
To go to the rescue.
And I think that's something to do with it.
So does this happen every time you get in the car with her?
Every time. And she barks continuously.
Right, well, do you know what? We could stand around all day, but I reckon we need to see the problem in the car.
Yeah. In. Good girl. Here we go.
Shall we rock and roll?
We shall rock and roll.
Very good. Oh, hello.
Yeah, here we go. As soon as I shut the boot door, she starts.
So she keeps this up all the time, does she?
Yes. She gets really stressed in the end.
I mean, is it distracting you as well?
Yeah, it distracts me. I can't concentrate. I get stressed out. I finish up with a headache.
Yeah.
I'm just glad when I get home.
So what impact is it having on your life then?
I can't take her where I want to go.
I mean, we must have been out for what, a quarter of an hour?
Yeah.
She hasn't stopped once, has she?
No.
She's getting anxious with all this.
Yeah. Talking, yeah. Yeah. She does get anxious. Yeah.
Initially, I thought it might just be a bit of attention seeking, but she is also anxious, and there's a really good reason why she would be anxious in the car. Well, frankly, she'd never been in one until she was being taken away from home to a rescue centre.
Down.
There you go. You know, this is dangerous. Christina's struggling to concentrate and just really worried that sooner or later an accident seems, well, frankly, inevitable. Sophie's got a really bad association with the car. If you're not used to a car, it's very unnatural. There's nothing in a dog brain that understands car. But I think there's another side to this, which is she's anxious in the car, and because you know what she's going to be like, you're anxious, aren't you?
Yeah, because I'm worried in case of a crash.
So I need to get you to act in a way where you're not so anxious. So I need to teach her that actually you don't want her to bark. It's not helping. In fact, it could be downright dangerous, really.
It is dangerous.
But also understand that when she's quiet, she's a good girl.
And the best of luck when you try it.
Thank you very much.
There's one thing which Graeme believes will make a major difference. Sophie's position in the car. He thinks the reason she's so anxious is the fact that she's far away, stuck in the boot, while Christina's driving.
I'm going to make a couple of changes. So what I want to do is put her in the back seat.
Right.
Because my thinking is, if she's a bit nearer to you, that's making her a bit more comfortable in the car, so she's less anxious. But in order for her to be safe, she needs to be on a harness that's attached into the seatbelt.
Yeah.
So that nothing bad can happen, you know?
Yeah.
Lovely. To teach Sophie to settle and stop barking, I'm going to use a command, calm down. But to get her to sink in, I'm going to put her on a long lead and give her a little flick when she barks. Now, eventually, I want Christina to be able to quiet her just using the command.
Barely down the road, Sophie's not barking, but clearly agitated.
Calm down.
As soon as her anxiety levels rise, Graeme nips it in the bud with a tug on the lead.
Oi.
And a command.
Calm down. Good girl. That's better.
She is crying, isn't she?
Yeah. Calm down. Good girl.
As the journey goes on, Sophie gets calmer.
So that sound's beginning to come down all the time now. So yeah. She's not barking, so now you can really hear that actually she's quite anxious. Whereas before, it was just rah, 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 rah. It's like, how would you know that was anxious?
It's heaven now.
Each time Sophie whines, Graeme keeps her anxiety in check.
Oi, calm down. Come
here. A couple of miles into the journey, and it's Christina's turn to take over giving the command, with Graeme giving the lead a tug.
Calm now.
Right.
That's too loud, is it?
Yeah. So, if you try and say calm down in quite an excited way, like calm down.
Yeah.
It doesn't sound like calm down at all. It sounds like rev yourself up. And if you're a dog, you don't really understand the words so much. You understand the sound.
Mm. So. Calm down. Calm down.
Better. Good girl. See, that worked. Good girl, yeah.
Good girl.
It's good, isn't it?
I'll give you a kiss for this.
Oh, I look forward to that. Has she ever been this quiet for this long?
Never.
No?
No.
As driving and using the lead is unpractical, Graeme needs to get Sophie to be able to respond to just Christina's command.
Oi. Calm down.
Well done. I was about to do it, you beat me to it.
Good girl. Good girl.
This is lovely, isn't it?
Oh, it's marvellous.
It's a great result for Christina. Just a few hours ago, she couldn't get off her driveway without Sophie's relentless barking. Now, she's sitting quietly on the back seat.
I'm going to hit the road, so it's been an absolute pleasure meeting you.
And you.
So keep practising, Chris. You've done a great job. And you?
You have as well.
I've done all right, haven't I? Time to go and help
Very
somebody
good.
Else. Bye-bye now.
Bye. Thank you ever so much, Graeme.
Take care.
Take care yourself.
I'm really pleased with the way the training has gone today. I think this is going to change Christina's life because she's able to get out now and go wherever she wants with Sophie, take her with her. Sophie's going to be so much happier as well.
and importantly, she'll be safe in the car. So all around, that's just a great win.
Driving along with Sophie being quiet is like heaven on earth. I feel so relaxed, and she can come everywhere with me. And I'm really pleased.
Coming up, Graeme may have got Sophie back on track, but in Essex, he still has a challenge ahead to make Romanian rescue dog Mojo man's best friend in the family home. Graham's week is drawing to a close, but he still has one big job to complete, helping Romanian rescue dog Mojo, whose hatred for men, including Dad John, is putting a strain on his owner's relationship.
We haven't got to the it's me or the dog stage yet, although...
Come close.
We have come close to it.
Having taken a unique hands-off approach to training last time, it was down to Karen to calm Mojo, while John slowly moved towards him, proving he was not a threat.
That makes me really happy.
But getting near Mojo outside is one thing. In order to have the dog he really wants, John needs to be able to interact with Mojo indoors.
The biggest problem that John's got with Mojo is in the house. That's what we're going to do today. And the purpose is to get Mojo to be as comfortable inside the house as he was last time outside on that bench.
I would like to be able to walk over and not get a response of bark, growl, panic, run.
Morning.
Come on in.
Come on, Dougal.
Come on.
So, since I was last here, how's it gone?
Really, really well. I know this morning we were practicing in the garden.
Oh, yeah? How did that go?
Really good. He came up to you. He didn't growl once. So I was telling him he was a good boy and he let you go and fuss him.
So that's really encouraging. The difficult bit, potentially, is in the house. Mojo's got to understand that he can come up and there is no issue with it.
OK. OK, good.
Fab.
Shall we go through?
OK.
In the park, John slowly approached Mojo and Karen. For today's training, Graeme wants to build on that. This time, however, Graeme wants Karen to walk with Mojo towards John, showing the dog he's not a threat.
Movement often helps.
Keeping Mojo on the lead means Karen can encourage him and he will feel safer being connected to her.
We're allowing him to discover that he can walk past John and there's no big deal. I want you to stop about here, look.
Great.
That's it. Let's just pause for a few seconds. There you go.
If Mojo remains calm and walks with her, he will be praised.
Well done.
Right.
But it's a slow process, and when John tries to reach out...
That's too much at the moment. Right, whoa.
Come on, then.
The key to the training is repetition. Getting Mojo used to walking in front of John.
Come on.
Yeah, he's telling him he's a good boy and he's looking and you're telling him he's a good boy. So he's like, OK, so if I look at Dad, then I'm a good boy. I've got it.
Graeme wants to get them even closer, putting Mojo between John and Karen.
Keep him that side. That's it. Perfect. Right. So, John, without looking directly at him, just put your hand on Karen's knee. So, like you might if you were just watching a telly at night. There you go. That's it. Good lad. So if you try and give him a little tickle with a finger, John.
Good boy.
There you go. Good lad. Lovely. Now, what I can see is when you turn your head away, he actually leans into you a bit. It's a tiny, tiny thing, but he leans his snout into you a little bit. As soon as you're looking at him again, he's like, oh, I need to look away.
For the first time ever, John is able to stroke Mojo in the house.
He's much calmer.
Yeah.
A lot less aggressive. So yes. Good.
It's lovely. It's what you hope for and it's what you want. It's why you have dogs.
It is.
With Mojo calmer than ever, Graeme wants to really put him to the test.
There you go. That's it. So don't have it tight, John, but just don't allow him to run away either. That's it. I don't know what he's going to do, if I'm honest. He might have a complete meltdown and a panic, okay. But we'll see. So I want you kind of to stand up and just kind of move to me if you can. Very matter of fact, very normal. That's it. I'm not making a big deal of it. Right, say nothing. Good lad. Don't let him run away. That's it. Oh, good boy.
Good boy.
So he's looking to see where Mum is.
And remarkably, despite his mum standing close by...
He's looking calmer now.
Mojo chooses to stay with John.
You're in full sight now. He's now seeing you. But he's not trying to get to you.
Good lad.
It's a great result for John. But time for one final challenge with the lead removed.
That's it. Take your time. That's it. No big deal.
And with no one holding Mojo, will he choose to stay next to John?
Oh, he's looking at you. Good boy. Give him a little tickle. Good lad. Good boy.
Good lad.
He sat willingly with his dad.
I got you.
It's an amazing transformation. Just a few hours ago, Mojo's fear of men meant he was terrified of being in the same room as John. But now...
Good boy.
He's happily sitting at his feet.
Mojo, come on then. Mojo, come on.
I'd rather stay with me, Dad.
Oh, come on then. Come on. Oh,
bless him.
Good boy. Good boy.
To see him finally sitting there and then to have his lead taken off and then not moving is just amazing.
Mm.
Really good.
Good. Yeah, yeah. Good. What about for you, John?
The encouraging thing was when he could see Karen and Karen started calling him, he was like, no, I'm all right. I'm here, thanks.
I'm with my dad.
I'm with my dad now.
Yeah.
It's all right.
Yeah, I mean, that's a fantastic result. Put it there.
Thank you very much, Graeme.
You've been great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well done for all the work you do with rescue dogs.
Thanks very much.
When I first arrived and saw the problem, I was really worried that perhaps Mojo, if he couldn't be fixed, would just lead a really miserable existence. And I'm pretty sure that's not now the case. So there's a bright future in this house with, you know, five rescue dogs and two people who know what they're doing. They've got work to do, of course, but this is a great result and I'm going home really happy.
Patch has transformed from confrontational to cuddly. Sophie is now the perfect passenger and Christina's social life is thriving. John is now able to walk Mojo on his own, and inside their bond is growing stronger too. Next time,
no, Chewie, come on.
A red setter who's nominated himself protector of the family.
I think if you didn't have a hold of him, I definitely think he would go for someone.
A cavapouchon pup with a penchant for running. And a family pet with a dangerous trait.
And that hurt. That really did hurt.